So do aliens exist? That's a huge question to answer. So to start off, let's start with our solar system. In our solar system, we've got the sun in the center, that's our star, and orbiting around, we've got 8 planets, and we live on one of them, the Earth. We think around some of those planets, like Jupiter, the moons that orbit around Jupiter, some of them could have alien life on them. But that would be very simple life, like bacteria. So if we want to find intelligent aliens that maybe we'd be able to talk to, we need to look outside our solar system. And we're not the only place with a star and planets. There's actually, we think, hundreds of billions, that's 100,000 million other stars in our Milky Way galaxy alone. And we think each of those stars probably has at least a planet, just one planet, orbiting around it. And so I think the chances of alien life existing out there in space is really, really huge, because there's hundreds of millions and billions of planets that they could be on. But we need evidence to prove it as scientists. And we use sometimes the Lovell telescope outside here at Jodrell Bank. We use it, we point it towards some of these planets to look for these radio wave signals. And we haven't found any over the last 50 years, nothing. So it's not looking great, but in the future, when we get bigger and better telescopes, we think our chances will increase and we should eventually spot alien life. I think we will discover it one day. Will we ever be able to talk to them? Probably not.
Sarah Bosman, and I'm an astrophysicist at UCL. I study mostly the early universe. Space is really enormous. It's so big that it's kind of hard to imagine, and the units we use on Earth, like kilometers or miles, don't even make sense to apply to space, because you just get too many zeros if you try to think of it that way. So astronomers had to come up with a whole new unit to measure distances in space, which is a light year. So for instance, our galaxy is 100,000 light years from one edge to the other. That means if you're traveling at the speed of light, which is the fastest you can ever go, it will still take you 100,000 years from one edge to the other. And that's only how big one galaxy is. So if we look outside of our galaxy to how many other galaxies there are, we just study small patches of the sky and count how many there are in each small patch. And the amount of galaxies we think are in the universe it's about 2 trillion galaxies, which is a ridiculous number. So if you took all these galaxies and split them among everyone on Earth, each person would have about 250 galaxies all to themselves. And that's only the space we know about. Now beyond that, there could be even more space.
So when light travels through a vacuum, that's as fast as anything can go. And a vacuum means that it's just empty space, so the light isn't traveling through air or dust or anything else. When it does travel through these things, it will slow down slightly, but when it's just traveling through a vacuum, that is its top speed. And we've measured that that's about 300,000 kilometers a second, which means that light could go around the whole Earth 7.5 times a second. When it comes to other things traveling faster than light, it gets a little bit more complicated. So a scientist called Albert Einstein came up with an equation that tells us anything that has mass will get heavier and heavier the faster it goes. So if you keep speeding something up, it's going to get more and more mass, it's going to keep getting heavier until it reaches the speed of light. And at that point, it has to have infinite mass, which is impossible. Something can't weigh infinity, it can't have infinite mass. So that tells us that nothing can ever travel at the speed of light. The speed of light is the top speed anything can ever travel.
Stars. There are loads of them. But how do we count them? On your fingers? With pen and paper? Pulling a random number out of a hat? Maybe not.
Counting stars takes a lot of time and a lot of effort. The first thing you should worry about if you look at the night sky and you're trying to count every single star is that you don't count the same one twice. So what we do to avoid that is give every single point on the sky a unique address. So in the same way as on a globe, you have longitude and latitude to find a place on Earth, we have the same for the sky. So once you have addresses like this and you're sure you're not counting each star twice, you divide the entire sky into tiny little squares. And then what you're going to do is take a picture of each of these squares, a very, very good picture, and then look at that picture and count how many stars you see. And you do this over and over and over. Back in the days, we used to attach cameras directly on the end of telescopes to take pictures. But that was often ruined by bad weather and other such things. So now we have sent a specialized satellite in space called the Gaia satellite, whose only job is to count all the stars it can see and how bright they are and how fast they're moving. Gaia has only been going for a few years and it's already counted 1.1 billion stars just around the Sun in our small part of the galaxy. So counting all of those by hand and making a list would take a bit too long.
Now imagine this, an asteroid hurtling towards Earth, and you have to come up with a plan to stop it. So what do you do? How about crashing a spacecraft into the asteroid to knock it out the way? Now it might sound a bit crazy, but that's actually NASA's plan.
The asteroid NASA want to hit is called Didymos and will be approaching Earth in October 2022 and then again in 2024. It's made up of two different parts, Didymos A and a smaller asteroid orbiting it called Didymos B. But they only need to target the smaller asteroid to stop the Earth being hit. It's the first ever mission to change the direction of an asteroid called the Double Asteroid Redirection Test. Or, if you want to be quicker, DART. Plans for the spacecraft got the thumbs up and they're about to start designing it. So, how will this all work? Well, it's expected to be about the size of a fridge. The spacecraft will shoot itself at the asteroid, deliberately crashing into it at 50 times the speed of a racing car. The force of the crash would physically knock the asteroid off in a different direction. It could be a spectacular moment in history.